Please join me in the call of worship. O Lord, who may abide in your tent, who is it who may dwell on your holy hill?
Those who walk blamelessly and do what is right and speak the truth from their heart, who do not slander with their tongue and do no evil with their breasts, or heap shame upon their neighbors, in whose eyes the wicked are despised, but who honor those who fear the Lord, who stand by their oath even to their hurt, who do not lend money in an interest and do not take a bribe against the innocent.
God has told you, O mortal, what is good. Today, we celebrate the teaching of Jesus, light of the world, Lamb of God, that guides our lives of Christian faith and action. Come, let us open our hearts in song.
Thank you.
We enter into a time of confession. Our Creator is merciful and just, and has promised to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. With such assurance, let us pause to confess the sins that have kept us from recognizing and enjoying God's presence. Merciful God,
we confess that we have not always been faithful to you through thoughts and actions.
You have told us what is good, O God. Your hopes for us are clear, and yet we live as though it is unclear what you would have us do.
We live as though we were not the recipients of grace upon grace. We live in hell when it is not our own. We judge where it is not our place.
Lord, we seek your forgiveness, reconciliation, and strength, so that we may follow in the way you would have us go. Cleanse us and guide us to rely on Jesus Christ. Amen. But God has told you, O or moral, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to do justice, and to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God? Here ends our first reading. Now a reading from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 5, verses 1 to 11. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went to the mountain, and after Jesus sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the poor in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who were persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And he talks about People who hear the words and act on them are like people who build a house on a rock, and people who hear the words and do not act on them, the rain will fall and the house will fall away. So that's the transition. And then in chapter 8, we go to Jesus and a lot of actions that he takes to heal people and stilling the storm and healing the paralytic and calling Matthew. And then, right before we get to chapter 10, in chapter 9, verse 35, on page 790, we hear that same verse again from chapter 4. Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness. So when you read the Bible, you find out that scholars like to call this an A-B-B-A formation. It's important. It's the gospel writer has put bookmarks in there, putting the same verse in the beginning and at the end of the section that he's trying to call our attention to. So in the beginning, we have Jesus, what Jesus is going to do, that it's going to involve teaching and doing. Then Jesus says, and I'm about to do things, and then he goes into chapter 8 and 9 and doing things. And then in the end of 9, Jesus finishes his exemplary teaching and doing. And in chapter 10, he sends the apostles out. So that's just, if you're following along during the week, that's just what you should notice about where we are in the gospel. So back in chapter 4, we found out that as a result of proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease, as we see in that verse 23, the fame of Jesus spread throughout all of Syria, and people brought him all the sick and those who were afflicted and who had various diseases and pains, and people who were possessed by demons or having epilepsy, or people who were afflicted with paralysis, all kinds of impossible situations. People brought those situations to Jesus, and Jesus cured them. And as a result, great crowds were following, not just from Syria, but from, which was a Roman province, but from the province of Galilee, and from the province, the Roman province of the Decapolis, which was on the east side of Israel, further in towards Arabia. And people from Judea, where Jerusalem is, in the south, and people from beyond the Jordan River. So Jesus' fame spreads from within the typically Jewish provinces of Galilee and Judea, and also outside these areas to Roman provinces with all kinds of mixed populations. And in today's reading, Jesus climbs to the top of the mountain because, and it almost sounds like he's fled there or moved there because there's a great crowd of people and he wants to address them. And so the lectionary puts this reading and contrasts it with the reading from Micah where God picked a mountain to have a fight with the people. But in today's reading, Jesus has something to tell us, but it's kind of the opposite of a fight. And I think it's important for us to notice what Jesus doesn't say in this Matthew reading. He doesn't give any commands, even though the setting reminds everyone of Mount Sinai. And Matthew believes that Jesus is a new Moses. And in the book of Exodus, Moses climbed the mountain and received God's law written on tablets and brought them down to the people. And commandments that Moses brings sound like, honor your parents, honor the Sabbath, do not murder, do not steal. They're kind of imperatives. But that's not what we hear today. Jesus isn't using the imperative. He's not commanding us, be poor in spirit. must be a peacemaker. You must put yourself in a position where you'd be persecuted for the sake of justice. You must be reviled and hated because of me. Jesus isn't telling us to do these things. He's not telling us to change who we are. Instead, I believe Jesus is describing scenes for us, scenes that we all have some connections to. Last week, Matthew said that Jesus took up John the Baptist's cry, "The kingdom of God has come near," and Jesus starts by telling us just how near God's kingdom is. God's kingdom is already here in our own experiences. We just didn't recognize them as good and holy. And so Jesus reminds us about some of these times. The first time we're seeing them, he reminds us as when he says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit." And I propose today that the right question is not who are the poor in spirit, but instead, let's consider this question: when am I poor in spirit? When are you poor in spirit? For me, right now, in this season, me and my family feel very poor in spirit. We have a family member who's struggling yet again with very serious alcohol addiction, and I feel powerless. And now my adult daughters have to experience that feeling of powerless. So I think when you're poor in spirit, that's when you feel discouraged, disappointed, and maybe even depressed. And perhaps you had like idealistic expectations that things should be different, and why aren't they different? And you worked so hard to do something about those. And it seemed like everything could be so great, but it didn't work out. And now you don't hold out much hope that those wishes will be fulfilled. For me, that's what this means. Jesus is saying, when I'm poor in spirit, which I hate being, that's a holy state. And the second emotional state I hear Jesus discussing is mourning. Now, each of us has mourned. You can't be human without mourning loss. We mourn our loved ones who are lost, our parents and children who have died, dear friends and family who are not dead but estranged. That's a loss, right? We can mourn any loss. The loss of our youth, the loss of our marriage. Mourning touches all of us. But how many of us feel that when we are mourning, we are blessed or lucky? Because the word for blessed also means lucky in Greek, makairos. Yet Jesus promises that God is with us most closely through all that loss and mourning. It's hard to make your mind around. Blessed are the meek, Jesus says, but how many times have I beaten myself up because I worried I was not forceful enough? Especially this week, as many of you prayed for me, as I was the moderator of the RCA's Commission on Theology, I was the only woman in the room, and I was in charge of making sure that it was a respectful conversation with people who disagree radically and a lot of tempers that are just flailing about. I worry, am I strong enough? Am I protecting vulnerable people enough? And now Jesus recalls to us these times. And he doesn't say, get tougher. He says that we are blessed when we are vulnerable, when we are mild, when we are gentle. And this meekness or gentleness, this word that is used here, is used two more very important times. In Matthew 11, Jesus says, "Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. So this is Jesus' big promise to us, that Jesus is not the God of judgment and anger, but gentleness and meekness. And then on Palm Sunday, we will read how Jesus reminds everyone of the gentle and kind king who is described by the prophet Zechariah when he rides into Jerusalem. And Matthew will use Zechariah's words, "See, your king comes to you gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." And Jesus does that to show us in a very palpable way how gentle he really is. He's not the kind of king who comes with an army and horses and swords and spears. Next, Jesus points us to those times that we are full of righteous indignation. And I battle with this myself. And I really don't like being in those situations, and I like to try to resolve them as quickly as possible, sometimes very poorly by getting angry. And when you're in that situation, what is it like? It's like we could see something good that could come about, but because people are not interested in what I'm interested in, or because they're greedy, or they lust for power, or they're apathetic, or they just don't care about what I care about, bad things that could have been prevented aren't prevented. And we are left hungry for justice, but seemingly with no hope to achieve that justice. And yet Jesus says that we are blessed when we hunger and thirst for righteousness and justice. It's the same word, dikaiosune. And then there's the opposite. Jesus is just showing us how full this spiritual life has to be. He goes right to the opposite. When justice is finally in our power to meet out. And you know, even on the commission, I could have thrown somebody out. I have that power. If they weren't obeying the rules that we'd all gone to, we are empowered sometimes to take an eye for an eye, and sometimes we need to do that. But Jesus said that we're especially blessed when we anguish over that decision, when we're wrestling with that righteousness and that sense of justice that we have, and we decide instead to put our hunger for justice aside. If you've ever been in a situation, and I can't imagine that any of you could be parents or godparents or grandparents or uncles or aunts without having those gut-wrenching times, and you just want to knock somebody over the head. And hopefully, like I'm lucky, there's good friends and advisors and husbands and people to tell us, hold on a minute. And somehow, however begrudgingly, instead of meeting out punishment, somehow we show mercy instead. And Jesus, I believe, knows our struggle. I'm sure that there were lots of times he wanted to just bum people. But he says simply, blessed are the merciful. And do you know anyone who ever boasts that they're pure in heart? I don't think we'd ever want to admit that we're pure in heart. When you're pure in heart, you always look for the best. You don't listen to the cynics. You don't expect the worst from people. And from the outside, it might look like you're setting yourself up for disappointment. And people around you might tell you that you're doing that. And of course, our fellow human beings will disappoint us. I have a coach who likes to say, the humans are just being humans. Nothing has gone But Jesus tells us that what's important is the purity of your own heart that matters. And that even if you are disappointed, holding on to that purity of heart is blessed. Blessed are the pure in heart, Jesus says. They will see God. So in these ways, we can see that Jesus has given us a list of things, but they're not things that we should try to be.
We remain seated for for our remote response number 835, one bread, one body, all three verses after the music.
Please rise and affirm. our faith in the Apostles' Creed. I believe
in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Before leaving, if you're interested, I have an advanced copy of the What's Next report from our discussions way back on October 30th. Consistory has been working on these ideas, and in fact, we've made some changes. So my position as pastor is now part-time, and that's been working out pretty well. And we're successfully sharing our sanctuary with another church, and not just that, but also engaging in activities, including Christmas worship and fellowship. And Consistory has a first proposal from our deacons to change our approach to monthly missions. And when you come back next week, Emily, who's leading this initiative and our board of deacons, we'll describe in depth, and it will also be in the newsletter, so look for that when it comes. So come and get one of these from me. And now I'd like to know, so that What's Next discussion is going to be on February 12th. We're skipping next week, because next week is Scout Sunday. So that's why we had communion this week, Scout Sunday next week, and then we'll have a What's Next discussion after worship on the 12th. And then after that, as the giant reward, we're going to reward ourselves with a chili cook-off. So there's a sign-up sheet right in the coffee hour to sign up for things that we need for the chili cook-off. And I hope that you participate in all these great things that Consistory is planning for you. Now, I wondered if you have prayer requests that are particular. Yes, Pat.
For Thanksgiving, my mother is celebrating her 97th birthday today.
That's amazing. Congratulations. I've gotten her first name, Joan.
Joan
jumped into my head as I made myself say it. Other prayers? Yes.
Yeah, my wife just thinks about her
How we will be praying for your wife. What is her first name?
Cheryl.
Prayers for our grandson Alex, who's going to be traveling to Louisiana next week.
It's far away. Will he be in Louisiana long?
He's going down there for perhaps a few days, and then he may be going further with his friend.
Okay.
I'm not sure.
Okay. Anything else? Lord, we come before you with prayers of petition and prayers of thanksgiving. In thanksgiving, Lord, we pray to thank you and praise you for the 97 amazing years for Pat's mother and Emily's grandmother, Joan. Lord, we ask you to continue to bless. bless her, to keep her heart full of your grace. We bless all of her family members who have done such a great job at helping her reach this beautiful milestone. We ask you to allow them to have a moment of great celebration, and that this will include and help her enter into her 90th year in grace and peace and as much health as possible. Lord, we pray for traveling mercies for the Island's grandson, Alex, who's headed to Louisiana. We ask you, Lord, to look after Alex and his friends, and to keep them safe, and to guide them in your wisdom and with your light. And we ask you to make this a wonderful trip for them and lead them into whatever's next in their lives. Lord, we pray that, and we lift up all the people in our hearts that are suffering with illness, and especially with cancer. We pray for Cheryl, who is Tom's wife. Lord, be with Cheryl this week. We lift her up and we put her into your hands, Lord, your hands of grace and mercy and healing. And we ask you for healing for Cheryl. Lord, we ask you to help Cheryl settle in her heart. And we ask you to help her and be with her in her anxiety and worry. And we ask you to be with Tom, because he's doing what you asked us most to do, which is never to leave our loved ones alone in their suffering. So hard when we're not suffering ourselves to watch a loved one go through this, Lord, and we ask you to fill Tom with your grace and encouragement. We ask you, Lord, to also, for my family, which is struggling with one of our family members who has a very serious problem with alcohol addiction. Lord, guide us and keep us together. Help us believe in your promises. Help us believe that you are caring for all of us and that you will never let any of us go. Encourage us and guide us and show us the best way to bring healing and life into this very difficult situation. And now, friends, I ask you to join together all these prayers and all the prayers that are in your hearts in the prayer that Jesus gave us and printed in your bulletin. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our final hymn of dedication is number 325, O Master, Let Me Walk With Thee, verses 1 through 4 after Susan's introduction.
Thank you.
fellowship and communion of our triune God bless you and abide with you and with all of us forevermore.